Can the dead be reborn? Is there life after death? This little boy believes there is.
Hello, my name's Camden.
Cameron remembers a past life on the remote Scottish island of Barra, over 200 miles away from his home in Glasgow.
I lived in the White House with my mum and dad, and my three brothers and sisters.
And he just talks about, I was in Barra and I fell through to you. And I'm saying, what do you mean? And he'll say, no, it was just like a hole and I fell through.
Children from all over the world report memories of previous lives. It's a pretty interesting phenomenon.
Together with psychiatrist Dr. Jim Tucker, Cameron and his mum are going on a search for evidence of his past life. Are there rational explanations for the remarkable coincidences which follow? Or are there stranger forces at work? Norma McCauley is a single mum who lives in Glasgow with her two young sons.
Oh, I've got two boys, lovely boys, even if I say so myself. I've got Martin, who's six, and I've got Cameron, who's five.
Since Cameron first started to talk, he has described life as a child on Barra, a remote island in Scotland's Outer Hebrides.
White House with my mum and dad and my three brothers and sisters.
From the age of two, Cameron has been telling his family the same story. As he's grown older, the story hasn't changed. It's just become more detailed. Norma could not understand how Cameron knew about Barra, let alone have such clear memories of life on the island.
At first I just thought, oh, he's making things up. And then I was thinking, how does he know the name Barra? Why is it Barra where none of us have been or have any connection with?
Barra lies off the western coast of Scotland, 220 miles from Glasgow. It can only be reached by a lengthy sea journey or an hour-long flight. It's a tiny, distant outpost of the British Isles and is home to just over 1,000 people.
My favourite place in Barra was the beach, and I took my dog with me and I play with him, and my brothers and sisters to play.
He used to say, I'm a Barra boy, I'm a Barra boy.
The planes was to land on the beach.
He said there's like a small beach. He says in like small planes land and they land on the beach.
At Barra is a loads of place to run around, but here is not a lot because the houses are near each other.
I did one time say, one of these days we will go up and see Barra. And then it's like, well, I'll show you where my house is and I'll show you round.
Will we see your Barra dad?
No.
Why not?
Because he's dead.
He's dead?
He says, my real Barra dad didn't look left and right.
Father, dad got knocked down.
Cameron even claims to know his Barra dad's name.
Shane Robertson?
Yes.
Who was Shane
Robertson again?
My Barra dad.
My Barra dad.
Was that fast?
Uh-huh. Was that the one that got knocked down?
Friends and family have also been drawn into Cameron's story. Next door neighbour, Diane Miller, has known Cameron since he was born. and her son Aaron has grown up with him.
Hello.
When they were about two was when Cameron started to speak about his Barra family.
And my brothers and sisters and my friends.
Well, you got friends in Barra too?
My house in Barra and family in Barra, because Cameron was adamant he had this other family.
What was his name?
Ian Doverson.
And he would tell you over and over again, so you know he wasn't just making it up there and then.
And he got knocked over by a car.
Cameron's uncle, Ian Watson, initially dismissed his nephew's stories as fantasy, but as time passed, they became harder to explain away.
It's just the fact that he's just consistent in, you know, the things that he's saying and the story that he keeps coming up with, and over the 3 years he's never wavered from. If you look at his face when he's telling you these things, he believes they're true.
My dad and mum had long hair and she got cut short.
You'll see, I was with my Barra mum before you had me, before I came to this family. And he just keeps saying to me, you'll really like her, you'll really like her, she's really nice. One time I said to him, joking, do you love me or your Barra mum? And he says, I love yous both the same. I thought he'd have said me, but he never.
Cameron's growing emotional attachment to his Barra mum concerned Norma. He began to miss her so badly that he started to suffer genuine distress.
One day when he was at the nursery, he got quite upset. He was saying rather than me picking him up that day, he wanted his Barra mum to come and get him. When the big tears were running down his face, and he just kept saying, I have to go to Barra, I have to go to Barra, my family are missing me. How do you deal with that? What do you do? What do you say to him?
Ever since he could speak, Cameron has described a previous life, growing up on the remote island of Barra in the Outer Hebrides. Cameron is desperate to visit Barra, but Norma, his mum, wants to find out if there is a rational explanation for his unusual memories.
I think I'm a very open person, but this was still throwing me. I mean, I believe Cameron does know Barra. How he knows it, I don't know. I don't think anybody really has every answer. But as I say, for somebody that is quite open, and it's thrown me. I'd just like to know, has he seen it on the television? Is there a house like he talks up there? Or just like to know what's behind it all.
At the University of Virginia, a department has been set up to investigate these stories. Psychiatrist Dr. Jim Tucker is the director of research.
So this is a worldwide phenomenon. It takes place in places and families with a belief in reincarnation and places and families without a belief in reincarnation. And in a number of the cases, the child's statements have been verified to be accurate.
Many of these cases show a pattern of consistent and detailed information.
The children will usually start talking about these memories at a very early age, usually two or three. Some of them talk about them matter-of-factly, but other children use great emotion in describing these things and will often long for the previous family.
Jim records the child's memories and investigates whether there might be a connection to an actual person who has lived before. Many of the cases seem to defy simple, rational explanation. One of Dr. Tucker's most celebrated cases was a boy he investigated from the Midwest of America.
This is a very interesting case of a boy who had memories of being its grandfather. And he said that God gives you a card to come back, and I guess this is a drawing of the card that he did.
Gus Taylor is the child who drew that card. Since he was a toddler, he has believed that in a past life, he was his own grandfather. Gus is now 10 years old.
When he was about 1.5, I was changing his diaper on his changing table, and he all of a sudden just looked at me and said, "You know, when I was your age, I used to change your diaper." And I went, whoa, this is...
Gus was named for his grandfather, and his full name is August. His grandfather had died the year before he was born, so he really didn't, he never got to know his grandfather. But he would insist that he was Grandpa Augie. If we were referring to Grandpa Augie, he would just say, "You mean me?" You know, he was just very adamant, like, we should know that he is Grandpa Augie.
"Where's me?"
"Yeah.
Where's me again? See if you can find me somewhere else."
Gus was 4 when Ron was given an old family album. To his parents' astonishment, Gus was able to point out his grandfather in an old school photograph. He also correctly identified this as the first car that his grandfather ever owned.
"He showed me a picture, and then I said, that was my first car. And then my dad was like, that's weird, because the car was Grandpa Augie's first car. So it was all scary."
Kathy and Ron were intrigued by their son's ability to identify his grandfather in photos. But one day, Gus told them something that turned their intrigue to shock.
Gus and I were chatting, and he started saying something about Grandpa Augie, which wasn't unusual. And I said to him, "When you were Grandpa Augie, did you have any sisters or brothers?" He said, "Well, I had a sister, but she died." And so that sort of caught my attention because, you know, we haven't had any deaths in the family. And he said, "Well, she died." And I just sort of looked at him and he said, "Yeah, she turned to a fish. She died, some bad guys."
I just was flabbergasted. I really was just so, I was speechless because I just couldn't understand how he would know anything about that.
Apparently what happened was his aunt was murdered, and her body was dumped into the San Francisco Bay.
There was no way he could know anything about her circumstances and how she died, because it was never discussed. And was barely discussed with me, with him, and my family. To hear my son, who didn't know my father, didn't know his aunt who was murdered, speak about this, and because that's when I just went, there's something going on here that I just don't understand.
For many in the West, reincarnation is an alien idea. Chris French believes that it's simply a comforting illusion which helps some people avoid the difficult realities of death.
On the one hand, you've got science that says once you die, that's it, that's the end, nothing else. On the other hand, you've got a belief system that says you will survive, you will be reunited with your loved ones. In a sense, you do go on forever. You know, how much more appealing can you get? I mean, we all want that, we'd all want to believe that.
For Kathy Taylor, her son Gus's belief that he was his own grandfather reborn went totally against her own religious upbringing.
I grew up a Southern Baptist. My father's a Southern Baptist minister, and Southern Baptists certainly don't, teach anything about reincarnation. So that was not, you know, that was furthest from my mind when Gus started saying these things. This one day he sort of popped up and looked at me and said, "You know, Mom, when we die, we get to come back." And he looked at me again and he said, "I used to be big and now I'm a kid again." And he was just very excited about this. He said that God gave him a ticket. And, you know, he also referred to a porthole and that he came through a porthole and that he used to be big and all of a sudden he's through this porthole and then he's a kid again.
Curiously, the description of the rebirth given by Gus in America has strong parallels with Cameron's account in Scotland.
You see, he talks about falling through from Barra to here. I asked him, "How did you get here?" And he just talks about, "I was in Barra and I fell through to you." And I'm saying, "What do you mean?" And he'll say, "No, it was just like a hole and I fell through," and that's all he says.
Caitlin, and
right.
What was the other one?
Megan.
Megan.
You're fucking Megan, I'm Caitlin. You fancy everyone who I want.
Aaron and Cameron had been playing and Aaron had mentioned how it's okay if you die because Cameron said you come back again as somebody else, so it didn't matter if you died.
It has become clear to Norma that there are no easy answers to the questions thrown up by Cameron's memories. Cameron has asked persistently to be taken to Barra. Norma has finally decided to make that journey.
We are going to go to Barra. I mean, it wasn't a decision that was made lightly. I've gave it an awful lot of thought. Stood up to an awful lot of folk that were against me doing it, and I just hope I prove them that I was right to do what I've done.
Come on.
Perhaps the trip will provide an explanation for Cameron's memories, or put them to rest.
You want to run now?
I think I'm hoping that when Cameron goes, it gives him proof, or, I mean, maybe go here and they'll say, "That's not Barra," so then that's fine, that's not Barra, end of story, that's the end of it. But I think it's reached a point, it's went too far. It's gone too far just to leave it now.
At the University of Virginia, Dr. Jim Tucker has been speaking to Norma and following Cameron's case with interest.
Well, Cameron's case certainly sounds like a very promising one. He's given the name of a place, which fortunately turns out to be a rather small place, and he's also given the name of a person. So with all the details that he's given, if we're able to verify a match, that would be quite intriguing.
For Jim, to follow a case as it unfolds is a unique opportunity. He is flying from Virginia to Glasgow to join Norma and pursue the story in person.
I mean, as it stands now, it's a very interesting story. If we're able to verify the statements, then it becomes more than that, because then it becomes evidence that he actually does have memories that have carried over from a previous life.
This is Cameron.
Hi, Cameron.
Cameron, you saying hello?
Hello. I'm Dr. Tucker. How are you?
This is Dr. Tucker.
Hi, Martin. Hello.
What can you tell me about the house that you left in?
It was white.
How many stories were there? Was it just one level or was it more than one?
One level.
Yeah. Did you see your dad get knocked out by the car? Yeah. You remember his name? Yeah, what was his name?
Shane Robertson.
Shane Robertson. Do you remember what he looked like?
He had
had spiky hair. And you always wear shirts.
Spiky hair, is that what you
mean? And always wore shirts.
Norma finally has someone to talk to who really understands her experience.
It was getting to a point he was acting convincing. I'm sure folk thought I've adopted him or like he wasn't really mine because he spoke so convincing about this other family.
And has it slowed down or is it still going as strong as ever?
It calmed down for a wee while but then it's back.
Is he excited about the trip?
Yeah.
Yeah.
After 3 years of listening to Cameron's descriptions of life on a remote island, Norma and Martin are taking him on a journey of another lifetime.
How's he going to react? What if he gets upset? What if we go and these things are there, how he's described?
Cameron is finally going to visit the place that he calls home. Norma and her sons Martin and Cameron are leaving Glasgow to fly to Barra, an island in the Outer Hebrides of Scotland, where Cameron believes that he lived in a previous life.
Not in my bag on.
They are being accompanied by psychiatrist Dr. Jim Tucker, an expert in children's past life memories. Cameron believes that his family name was Robertson and that he lived in a big white house, a house full of children. He says he had a black and white dog. There was a view from the house to the sea, and that they could see planes land, not on a runway, but on the beach. Could any of these apparent memories correspond to reality?
You know, there's a concern that if he really is having memories of a previous life, that taking him back to that place might be traumatic. But what usually is the case is actually the reverse, that seeing the old place kind of puts the memories in perspective so that the child is then able to let go of them more.
The plane was to land on the beach.
They go into the airport to collect their bags.
He was saying he used to go over that bit over there, and when they used to see the rainbows, they used to try and jump up and get them. They're too high, aren't they?
Well, we're certainly off to a good start. I mean, he feels that he recognizes the place. He said to his brother, I told you it was true, and he's very excited about being here.
Mummy, I'm used to always come down to this bit, and I'm used to play at the beach.
Did you? You'll be able to show me, won't you?
It's very exciting. If we can verify his statements, it'll be a great case. Looks like a place that doesn't change too rapidly, so hopefully he'll be able to recognize some things.
Feel happy to be back.
Feel happy to be back, do you? You look happy to be back.
Then we're scorching up the stairs.
Leaving the airport, they board the bus to drive to the hotel, and they get their first look at the island.
Mummy.
What?
Well, you might see it in the horizon or on the way.
I know, we're trying to see if we can see it.
You know what? I know the person who lives there, but...
You know the person that lived there?
Mm-hmm, but I can't remember. Mummy, it's hard to get to that bit.
You have to get out.
Mm-hmm. Because then you'd have to try and swim back. Mummy, I think I can use this to the bit.
Next morning, the investigation begins in earnest. Norma and Jim set off to visit the local heritage centre to look for any record of the Robertson family and the man that Cameron calls his Barra Dad.
My Barra Dad was called Shane Robertson and he got knocked down.
Hello?
Norma, pleased to meet you.
Callum McNeil is the island's local historian.
Tucker.
Callum McNeil.
Nice to meet you.
Certain of them names don't immediately come to my mind. Certainly the name Robertson does feature, but certainly not the name Shane. And the name Robertson itself only features occasionally in the history of the islands.
There doesn't seem to be any evidence that a family called Robertson lived in a house by the shore. Could Cameron be wrong about the name, but right about the house?
I could see the beach when I look out the window, and sometimes my brothers and sisters could go by themselves, and I looked out my window, see the planes land on the beach. And my brother has had a black bonnet, and how you dial is you just go like that.
He has provided some clues about the location and the period in which he says he lived on the island.
Since he's talked about the planes landing and talked about phones, what sort of era would that put him in?
More than likely after the war. More than likely after the war.
And since he's talked about the plane landing and seeing that, we're probably thinking of a family toward the north end.
Yes, I would say so. If the toing and froing of aircraft from the beach is featuring highly, that would indicate the north end of the island.
It's not much to go on, but they set out on a trail back to the north end of the island.
I thought he was fine, but I don't know about him. I was starting to feel anxious and saying, well, I hope he does recognise something for his sake and probably for my own, because I'm desperately looking for answers as well.
Well, I think it's disappointing if a child goes to a place and doesn't recognise things. Often what happens is that by the time the child gets taken to the previous place, they're beginning to lose the memories anyway. Children seem to lose these memories by the age of 6 or 7. And this is the age where children are starting school and getting more fully wrapped up in this life.
They have driven past many of the houses on the island, most of them white, some near the sea. But Cameron recognizes none of them.
Sometimes I say I wish I could get in his head just for 5 minutes to see what it feels like to him. Because obviously to him it's real.
My dad and mum had long hair and she got cut short.
Later that day, they go for a walk on the beach. The adults may be disappointed, but Cameron is happy just being on the island. But next morning, they receive a phone call from Callum McNeil at the Heritage Centre. He wants to speak to them urgently. He has some new information.
Phone call today informed me that there were people living with the name Robertson on the north end of the island. In a house by the shore. It's a white house by the shore. Couldn't get much closer to the shore.
Callum's records were only for properties owned by islanders, but the Robertsons were from the mainland.
And when were they there?
60s, 70s, I believe.
So we know exactly which house it was. We'd be able to go see it.
Sunderland.
Directions to the house take them down a different road to the ones they had been searching before. Jim and Norma don't tell Cameron where they are going. They don't want to influence his reaction or disappoint him. They follow a small coastal track. The house comes into view as they turn the final corner.
Sean, are you alright? Is this your house? No, you get sad, is this your house?
Gone.
You're getting a wee bit upset.
How?
It's okay.
Does it make you feel a wee bit sad?
The usually chatty Cameron has become strangely subdued. Just below the house, there are rock pools, and there is a gate to the beach.
There's a gate round there. They said that was a secret way. They called it the secret way into the house. He's just saying he's excited, but he's sad as well. I think he's surprised and he's not sure how he's feeling. I'm not sure how I'm feeling either, to be honest. Can we come in? We've got a fire like that, haven't we?
Let me look.
What?
Look.
I know. Wow. You okay?
Although much of the furniture and decor is recent, some of the features of the house, like the open fire, have remained unchanged for decades.
I could see the beach when I looked out the window, and something my brothers and sisters could go all by themselves, and I looked out my window see, and I saw them playing.
The girls were in this room?
Yes.
And you, the boys were in the other room?
Yes.
Yeah.
talking? Was it the same stuff?
Mm. Did you just have the fire lit?
Are you glad you came here to see it?
Did you think your Barra mum was going to still be here? Yeah? No. Do you miss her? You got me, haven't you?
About ready to go back home now? Yeah, get on the plane and fly home.
Well, it's been quite an interesting trip. I mean, we came here with a name and a description of a house, which is not very much to go on. And we found that, in fact, there was a family here. And that, in fact, they had a house in the right location and the right appearance of what we were looking for. At this point, the investigation remains inconclusive, but we've got some very solid leads to go on, and we should be able to find out the details of this Robertson family to see if, in fact, they do match with what Cameron has been saying.
Back in Glasgow, Norma has arranged a meeting with Ruth Boreham, a genealogist who has investigated the Robertson family history for her. She has found that the Robertsons came from Glasgow and that they owned the house on Barra for more than 20 years. She has traced a Gilly Robertson, who still lives in Scotland.
But you don't know when they need it, and I've been able to find it. A phone number and an address for Gillian and her husband.
Gilly Robertson would have been a child holidaying in the house on Barra at the same time as Cameron believes that he lived there.
I can pass that on to you and...
Just so would we be allowed to contact her?
Her address and phone number is in the BT phone book, so it's public knowledge, so that would certainly be a possibility. And she was... She fits with the right sort of age.
Yes,
she had two brothers and a daughter.
Wow.
Norma now has a name and telephone number for a living member of the Robertson family. The search for answers is nearing its conclusion. This is the house that 5-year-old Cameron believes was his home in a past life. He believes that he lived here with his family, the Robertsons. The house, which exactly fits Cameron's description, was once actually owned by a Robertson family who spent their summers here in the 60s and 70s. Cameron's mum, Norma, has traced Gilly, one of the Robertsons, and arranged to visit her. But now, back in Glasgow, Cameron's reaction to the news comes as a shock.
Last night was just an outburst. One minute we're laughing and joking. Everything was fine, and then it was just... there was tears, and then the saying he was frightened, and then the next thing, him and Martin were fighting. It got a wee bit out of hand. It was like somebody had flicked a switch. He went from happy to... And it was, I'm scared, I don't want to go, I don't want to go, Mum. But this morning he came in quite wide awake and started asking me about Gilly Robertson. And at one point I thought it was quite strange, he actually says, could Gilly be my sister if she was a wee girl at the house? And it's kind of, I think we've all been thrown a bit. Now he's asking, can he go, he wants to go and meet her.
Hi there. Pleased to meet you, I'm Norma.
Hello,
very nice to meet you. This is Cameron.
And Martin, come on.
This is Cameron's big brother, Martin.
He's finding somebody that's possibly his sister. Is he thinking, oh, maybe I'll need to go back to that family? Because in Cameron's mind, the Robertsons were his Barra family. And I think that's what's frightened him. I mean, it's quite frightening.
This is the house here, and down below the house, a lovely beach.
Was that what it was like when you were in Barra?
Yeah.
But could you recognise it quite well when you went to see it?
Although you were saying it had changed.
Yes, you see, I think it has changed. Mm-hmm. I think the person who's bought it now has modernised it.
Yeah.
I played on the beach and took my dog and played fetch with my dog at the beach.
Could I see when you went to Barra, did you have a dog? Was there a dog there?
Well, certainly Callum and Peggy, who lived in the house, they had a dog, a sheepdog.
The black and white dog is just as Cameron remembers. But what about the name of his Barra father, Shane Robertson?
Well, certainly there aren't any Shanes in our family. There were, one of my uncles was called James.
Yeah.
Now, Seamus James, you know, that's quite a common connection.
Yeah,
one of my cousins is also called James, but certainly not a Shane.
Was the car accident on Barra?
This is what we don't know. He doesn't seem to be able to tell you.
I don't know of anyone in our family who died in a car accident.
That's how I was curious as well, if maybe even there had been a child in the family had passed away. Or...
No, certainly there were no deaths of children in that close family.
So while many parts of Cameron's memory fit with extraordinary precision, others do not. The family name matches, so do the physical details of the house, the island, and the dog. But the name and death of the father figure do not.
First I thought, I'm going to be disappointed if it doesn't make sense. And then there's a part of me, I think it would have been too freaky if everything was 100%. A lot of the things tie in and match up, seem to match up perfectly, where there's other things just don't fit in at all. But I look at it as, if I'm describing my past or trying to tell you things, there's things I would probably remember and tell you spot on, and there's other things, if my sister was telling the same story, it would be different. I just think there's been more things tied in than didn't.
If these, in fact, were past life memories, then we have to look at the question of why some of them were correct and some weren't. Was this just a remarkable coincidence, or could it be something more? He could have had memories from more than one life, and they could have gotten mixed in together. There's just a lot that we don't know about it.
And I don't think I realised myself how much it might affect me going into the house. I mean, for a split second, I actually felt as if I could be physically sick. It was, I don't know, and then there was the worry, what if all these memories come flooding back to Cameron and upset him? And then also I was thinking, what if he has had another mum?
He certainly responded to the house in a way that made it seem that this was a special place for him. He may have had some memories and emotions that somehow existed on this island beforehand in another life and then somehow carried over to him.
I personally think there's more to it than meets the eye, but there are some people, and everybody's allowed to make their own judgment, but I definitely think it's one of those things, there's something there. I can't tell you what exactly it is, but I think it's something we'll probably never know.
In the end, there are no tidy answers. But one thing is clear. The persistent memories that Cameron once had of another life on a far-off island trouble him no longer.
I think that since Cameron's been to Barnet and the fact that we've seen it for ourselves, it's as if it's put it to rest in his mind that he doesn't have to go on and prove it anymore. And he just seems so calm about it. Before it was, everything was hyper and jumping about, and where it's like, yes, I was at Barnet, I seen my house. It's just so calm now, it's quite unbelievably changed.
We don't remember much details from our childhood.
Meet again, don't know where.
But what if this is so?
But I know we'll meet again.
But what if that is from before your birth? This boy does remember, and Cameron is a name, 5 years old. The name of his buried dad, Shane, does sound like James, that's obvious. The name of the island, the name of the family, the brothers and sisters, the house, the dock, the airplanes landing on the beach itself. The psychiatry department seeks ours for reasons for not accepting our spiritual being. The unknown makes them frightened. They do not control it. The psychiatry is weak and scared. After the visit to the place and the house of a distant past, the boy has found peace within himself once again. Not many has the kind of experience that Cameron had. It's perhaps only a blessing when you know what's going on. But believe me, it's not that mysterious. Everywhere in the world, many, especially children, has paranormal abilities and experiences. The secret way is finally revealing itself to everyone on Earth.